Pilots say an Olympic swimming pool 50 meters long and 25 yards wide could be viewed from a passing plane at 5,000 feet. From that height, they say it can look like a gemstone shimmering in the sun. One such pool on the Joint Forces Training Base in Los Alamitos has become a jewel of another kind, shining brightly in West Orange County, and for over a decade now, around the world as a USA Water Polo National Training Center. This Olympic pool here in Los Alamitos is the home of the USA women's water polo team, and since 1996 has hosted men's and women's international water polo at its raw and explosive best. USA Water Polo is certainly a crowd pleaser and a banner program at this aquatic center.
And that's a hat trick for Petrie on the evening.
But it is far from the only popular program here. On any given day, while you may find the USA Women's Water Polo team scrimmaging at one end of the pool, at the same time there'll be one or more programs underway at the other end. Like the venerable gold medal Olympian Greta Anderson, famously coaching one of her one-year-olds in the water, shouting, "Big arms, big arms!" And beyond her, in the far lanes, ongoing safety classes for older kids and teens. Greta loves the pool, says she has trained 700 or 800 kids in it, and she says she is good for probably 700 or 800 more. The pool accommodates over 1,000 swimmers a week with a dozen swimming programs and user groups from adult and junior swim clubs to city-run lap swim and water safety classes. And of course, these tiny toddlers who learn to swim for Greta in this pool, sometimes before they can even walk.
It's a wonderful pool and it's always kept up very nice and it's nice and warm and it's a beautiful location and I feel really much at home here. I like it here. Oh, I wouldn't be here.
Okay, let's go. Look at that. Hey, hi.
All of these active programs call this aquatic center their home. And from these water babies to Olympic superstars, this 50-meter Olympic pool can accommodate them all. But it wasn't always the case.
Hi, I'm Rick Papp, alongside Lieutenant Colonel Tom Lasser and Olympic gold medalist Dina Dierdorf-Schmidt. We're poolside here at the USA Water Polo National Training Center on the Joint Forces Training Base in the city of Los Alamitos.
Inviting you to take a trip back in time with us as we recall a miracle in the making at this public aquatic pool you see behind us.
And share with us the ups and downs, the highs and lows, the heartbreaks and the heroes of this 50-meter miracle that almost wasn't, and the success story that it is today.
To observe the daily operations of this aquatic pool in Los Alamitos, you would come to the casual conclusion that it's always been like this. An oasis of a pool teeming with life, robustly supported by national sports programs, municipal aquatic classes, and local swim clubs. But the road to success over the years has hardly been assured. From its origins back in 1942 as initially a training pool and later a recreational facility for military personnel only, the Olympic pool on the base had an on and off again history. By 1995, this 50-meter Olympic pool had been abandoned. and left in a half-drained state to the algae and the frogs. Base commander at the time, Lieutenant Colonel Jim Gormley, describes to Tom Lasser the early days.
Here today with Jim Gormley, retired Lieutenant Colonel, former airfield commander, former base commander here at Los Alamitos. And we're going to talk about the pool, the history of the base, and what's going on here at Los Al at the pool. And Jim has a lot of background. And Jim, tell us the story of the pool.
Well, thank you very much, Tom. Actually, the story goes clear back to 1942. And as a matter of fact, this wall is a brand new wall. This is the first time I've been in here since all of these improvements have been made. But in 1942, the base was commissioned. About 6 months after the commissioning date in 1942, the pool was built. And the pool was built for recreation. It was built for military emergency training, something the military calls drown proofing. It was used for pilots, it was used for Marines, it was used for crew members. So then we fast forward to the early 70s, and by the way, the pool remained in operation all that period of time. We fast forward to the early 70s, and in the early 70s, the Army took over operation of the airfield, and the Navy retained operation of what we would refer to as the cantonment area of the base. And that included the swimming pool. So the swimming pool continued to operate, again, as a recreational facility and as an emergency training facility, again, using it for drown proofing for military personnel, military enlisted personnel, pilots, Marines, that sort of thing. And then we get to the late 70s when the Army took over the entire base. When the Army took over the base, the pool remained in operation for a very short period of time. But the Army, through the Army National Guard, did not have a mechanism to keep the pool going. And therefore, the pool went into a fallow state. And it remained like that until the late 80s, early 90s. In the late 80s to early 90s, the Army National Guard had the opportunity to be able to use some morale, welfare, and recreation dollars and bring the pool back online to a point. In 1991, however, that money dried up. There was no more support for the pool, and the pool went very fallow. And as a matter of fact, the pool that you see today is nothing like the pool that I saw in 1996 when the USA Water Polo Foundation came to me and said, gee, can we do anything with that pool? At that time, the pool was a frog pond. You could walk across that pool almost on the algae and the detritus that had grown into it. It was still full, but it was the term full is a relative term. It was full of everything but good swimming water. In any event, a gentleman by the name of Richard Foster, who was the then president of the USA Water Polo Foundation, came to me and said, is there a way that we could look at the pool? I might be able to get $500,000 to refurbish that pool. And that's where the whole refurbishment process started. And
so I checked with Los Alamitos and talked with Colonel Gormley. And he said, well, come on and take a look at the pool. And I came over here to Los Alamitos. And Colonel Gormley allowed me to look all around and stuff. And it was pretty depressing.
Then president of USA Water Polo Incorporated, Rich Foster, remembers his original idea to turn the dormant base pool into an aquatic center for the USA men's team, a challenge even he wasn't too sure about in the beginning.
None of the equipment worked, the heaters, the chlorinators, none of the operating systems worked. There were maybe 3 feet of water in the pool. It was
nicknamed the frog pond.
That was a good nickname. And there was plants all the way to the top of the water. And it was pretty depressing. And he gave me some plans that they had drawn up a few years earlier to redo the pool, and that was $500,000. And back in 1995 dollars, that was a big sum to us. And so I left thinking, there's no possibility this is gonna happen.
As we said a little bit ago, the thing was completely full of algae, frogs, and everything else. And there is a labyrinth of tunnels and conduit stuff underneath this pool, and the contractor that refurbished all of that had to go down and go through every one of those. The pool is heated, for crying out loud. I've not seen the equipment room, but the new equipment room, I understand there's a new equipment room in terms of support for the pool, But the old equipment was in that was in there was initially refurbished. And every once in a while, it would decide that it was going to take a rest and you'd get a blowout here and a blowout there. Mm-hmm. One time the sand filter blew out and there was sand everywhere and pool water. But in any event, the pool obviously is the centerpiece of this whole thing.
What can you tell us about the deck here?
Well, you know what? If you look at the deck, it has some repairs on it.
Scars?
But yes, from previous use. But this is, we're walking on 1942 concrete. This concrete was never replaced. As a matter of fact, the shell of the pool is still the original shell. The pool was never hammered out and a new pool put in. And it gives you some idea of the quality with which it was built in 1942. Also, you see this drain around the edge of the pool. The pool did not have an overflow drain when the rehabilitation first started, and so they had to go in and actually put this scupper facility in all the way around this pool. And it not only was it expensive, but it was very time-consuming to put it in.
The only thing that was good about that pool was the pool structure itself. You could have thrown that pool in the ocean, it would float.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. And amazingly, it was built back in the 40s. This was for the military.
Yeah.
And I don't think they were using it in terms of swimming. It was more training.
Yeah.
And you really were criticized a little bit because you did take a chance here. You wanted the pool to succeed.
Well,
but you needed about $500,000 to do it.
Well, yeah, and I spoke to USA Water Polo's executive director, who was out of Florida. He was one of my employees, and he said, well, he was going to contact the Pool and Spa Association, the national organization, see what he could do. And I was able to get, in talking to the U.S. Olympic Committee, they committed $100,000 to the project. USA Water Polo put in, I think, about $80,000. And Bud Weisbrod from the Pool and Spa Group put us in touch with California Commercial Pools. I said, had him down there and said, hey, I got $180,000. Is there anything possible here? And he looked at things and he kind of said, yeah, I think we can do something. And so they worked with the Pool and Spa Association. They got contractors to come in and give us stuff at cost or for free. And California Commercial Pools did all their stuff just at cost. And they were able to renovate the pool, so it was in operating condition. They did some repairs on the operating systems. But the big thing is they got all the pipes and stuff redone. And for $180,000, we got ourselves a pool.
And not any too soon. For just a few months in the spring of 1996, the USA men's water polo team were able to train and compete in their own home pool in Los Alamitos for the first time. Shown here hosting Russia in one of their first games at the recently refurbished pool.
USA swimmers out swimming. Come away with the ball.
This score would have been a miraculous stop there by Merrill. Instead now a 12-9 game in favor of Montenegro. Team USA running short on time and chances.
But at the 1996 Olympic Games, the USA men's water polo team did indeed run out of time. Failing to reach even the semifinals in the games, the public's interest in men's water polo after Atlanta declined. Operating funds dried up, and back at their home pool, sections of the piping and the filtration systems that had not been restored in 95 also began to fail. The pool that Rich Foster had staked his claim on for USA Water Polo came to be referred to as Foster's Folly. And this 50-meter makeover turned into one big Olympic frog pond once again.
Right after the 96 Olympics, the pool kind of went down. I mean, the structure was still good, that what California Pools did, but they were only able, with a limited amount of money, to fix, put Band-Aids on the operating systems, heating and chlorination, that kind of stuff. So the pool kind of broke down.
There were so many hurdles, many obstacles. At times you felt like giving up, or?
There was one time when I felt like giving up, because in 1996 I was up for re-election for president of USA Water Polo. And that was at that time, this was late in 1996, and the operating systems had stopped working efficiently. And the person who ran against me for President of USA Water Polo came in the day of the election with all these brochures and handouts that Rich Foster was going to bankrupt USA Water Polo with this pool. It's Foster's folly. And I lost that election because of the pool.
Rich Foster's shattered dream of an Olympic home for USA Water Polo did not languish for long, though. Enter the city of Los Alamitos in 1998 with an unlikely source pressing upon then-Mayor Ron Bates to take some action to once again reactivate the pool.
And there was a breakdown in that pool, and you were aware of the pool over at the Armed Joint Forces Training Base. Tell us how this all started.
Yeah, Rick, it was interesting because you're right. The pool at the high school was being heavily utilized, and occasionally it would break down. And of course, then the kids had nowhere to practice. They'd try to go down to the pool in Seal Beach. That wasn't working well. And the pool was utilized at the high school so much that a lot of the programs for the women, both swimming and water polo, were way late at night. And these kids were coming home at 9 o'clock in the evening, cold, tired. Just so happened that one of those kids was my youngest daughter. So I got it loud and clear that maybe we need more capacity for Los Alamitos in the swim program. And certainly the pool at the Joint Forces Training Base was a wonderful opportunity for the community.
Thanks to his daughter's involvement in high school water sports, Mayor Bates was made keenly aware that the pool program at the high school was overburdened, with breakdown problems of its own, so he took the initiative to enlist the city staff and local private interests in considering a plan to put the city of Los Alamitos on a partnership footing with other stakeholders at the pool. The first person he went to was his longtime Parks and Recreation Director, Mark Wagner, to pose the question, could the little city of Los Alamitos, with its limited size and resources, afford to take a lead role in a pool that had faltered several times before? Wagner's immediate can-do response was yes, but saying it, he recalls, would prove a lot easier than pulling it off.
Really?
Yeah, you know, it was funny that this was a project that the problems were monumental. In fact, we stopped referring to the problems as monumental. We started looking at them as challenges. And then instead of focusing on challenges, we had to focus on solutions. And that was truly, you know, the only thing that we could do to go
forward.
Shortcut
it and move forward.
Yeah.
But this took money.
Yeah.
And tell us the little chain of events, how it came about.
Well, Ron, Mayor Bates, when he came to me, his first thought was, is there anything we can do to renovate the facility? And he also recognized that the only way that this facility could be a viable project is if we had a team of people that came together and worked on the project together. And that's what was the first thing that he asked me to do, was to bring the community and the various community groups, everybody from the mayor from the military to the Supervisor Jim Silva, to the community-based groups, to U.S. Water Polo, all of the potential users of this facility to determine whether there was interest enough to partner together to move forward.
For Ron Bates, getting involved meant getting political, at first locally, then at the county and state level. As then president of the California League of Cities, Ron had the access and the credentials to reach all the way to Sacramento, and his own way of getting there.
I tried to do the political work and get a lot of the elected officials involved in supporting it. And from my background in local government, tried to think of it of how can we make it so that the little city of Los Alamitos isn't bearing all the cost for operating the pool.
The military ultimately played an essential role in the success of this Olympic pool. When they begin to see the value of the pool and community involvement to the overall health of the base. And no base commander understood this better than Brigadier General Guido Portante, who was present at every stage of the pool's development, and at one point is base commandant.
Here on this patch of green poolside at the Joint Forces Training Base, I'm with Brigadier General retired Guido Portante, former base commander here at the JFTB. Welcome to the base, General.
You know, Tom, it's really good to be back and see what's going on this base. It brings back fond memories for me.
General Portante was instrumental in the origins and the military development of the pool. And tell us your first recollections of what the pool was like early on.
Well, I go way back because I was one of the original seven military men that came and took the post from the Navy in 1977. And the Guard, the National Guard, California National Guard, became the host for this facility. And even way back then, I would come over to the pool here, and I would look into the pool, and it had, you know, a few feet of water. It was green. It had algae in it. And yes, and you'll probably bring this up, but we actually had some frogs in there also. thus the name, the frog pond. And I always wondered, way back then as a young captain, you know, how could we do something with this pool to benefit the soldiers primarily? And I wasn't thinking of all the other aspects that have come about since then.
What are your recollections of the involvement by the Olympic water polo team in the city when they approached the base?
Well, early on, Mark Wagner, recreation head of the recreation department of Los Alamitos, the city of Los Alamitos, we would talk, small talk about it. I don't think either one of us really realized what was going to transpire. And along about, I think it was in 1998, we had a major meeting here with the city mayor, Ron Bates. I think it was Ron Weigel of the USA Water Polo Federation, and some other players, Russ Johnson, myself representing the military department, on how we were going to proceed. And I think that meeting was a catalyst for this whole thing coming about.
In early 1998, a kind of summit meeting was convened in this building at base headquarters of all interested parties to the pool's latest restoration effort. It included not only city, USA Water Polo, and base officials, but reached out to the County of Orange, local swim clubs, the public, and the surrounding business communities. A new partnership was forged out of that meeting, this time with the City of Los Alamitos leading the charge.
And we were able to put a group together that included the military, the county, the state, the local cities in the area, plus a person who helped us a lot, George Brigaman, brought in the first private money to help us put this whole package together. And literally, we had starts and stops all along the way. We think we have everybody on the same page, and maybe the military didn't like the program at that time. And so then we'd go back to the drawing board again and try to see, is there a way to make all this happen? One of the things that we were concerned about as a small city is that it's great if we could get it back in operation and working, but two problems existed. One, the cost of operation of the pool was very high. And then secondly, it needed a lot of, you know, capital improvements. So that was the challenge that was facing us when we got involved.
In the spring of 98, the Los Alamitos Aquatic Pool Foundation was formed under the authority of the city to fundraise for the pool and manage its finances. Officers of the foundation included the mayor and USA Water Polo's Rich Foster, as well as businessman George Brigaman Jr., who pledged the first private money to get operations going.
For his very generous contribution, as I say, with this contribution, it makes the difference of getting much of the capital improvements done to bring this pool back online. So.
But it would take larger infusions of cash from public sources to fill the still-drained pool and repair the antiquated filtration system that had broken down yet again. Some relief came in the summer of 98 with a county grant brought forward by then-Supervisor Jim Silva in the amount of $200,000. It was the small miracle Bates and Foster had hoped and worked for in their efforts to resuscitate a city-run pool and create a training center for the USA Women's Water Polo Team.
Well, first of all, the county was in bankruptcy, so money was very, very tight. But as a former high school coach, I coached football, I felt that it was very important that we make sure that our young people have activities. To keep a youngster at that time in juvenile hall was close to $40,000 a year. To keep a baseball field, 1 acre, active for youth sports was about $40,000. I would rather spend $40,000 and keep 250 kids active than one child in juvenile hall. So we were able to take $250,000 and put it towards this pool to revitalize it so the women's Olympic team, a female water polo team, would be able to have a place to work out. But I have to be very honest with you, and I said it the day that we dedicated this facility, I wanted it because of the young people in this community that would learn to swim in this pool. We're right now a mile and a half from the ocean. We don't have enough pool facilities to handle the population of young people learning to swim. So that was my big motive. But the fact that the women's water polo team called that home base, I think that was icing on the cake.
In 1995 and 96, some of the basic work on the pool's heating and plumbing system was accomplished at or below cost by a group of pool contractors pressed into service by Rich Foster.
This site will be the capital of water polo in the United States.
And his longtime USA Water Polo associate, Bruce Weigo. This time working closely with city and base officials, they brought back those same contractors to coordinate a second rehab of the pool in 98.
This was Rich's idea, and he asked me for my help and assistance, and together we really collaborated on putting this deal together. It was Rich that worked with the city of Los Alamitos primarily in the early days. It was Rich that worked with the military staff. And my job was to try and raise money from the U.S. Olympic Committee, and together we went to the U.S. Water Polo Foundation to get needed money. And together we really worked with the guys that I brought in from the National Swimming Pool Foundation, Bud Weisbrod and Lee Jackson. So it was really a team effort on the part of everybody, and I think it was for a good cause.
Bud Weisbrod was their go-to guy and something of an icon in the commercial pool industry. Credited with creating an enormously successful consortium of professionals in the commercial pool world. And it was again Bud Weisbrod and his Aquatic consortium that city and water polo officials once again leaned on in the summer of 98 to bring the pool and its substandard filtration system and corroded pipes up to operational standards. Just in time to support the opening of the USA Women's Water Polo Training Center at the pool.
Once we understood what the budgetary dollars were, and they were over $1 million actually in capital needs at the project, because the pool literally, there were no restrooms, you know, the filtration system was, you know, 50 years old, on and on and on and on.
Basically just a hole in the ground.
Yeah, it truly was. Yeah. But there was a gentleman by the name of Bud Weisbrod, and Bud was the president of Aquatic, which is a company here in Huntington Beach. And Bud had, he was also, had the ability to work with major equipment people all over the country. And Bud was involved in working with Rich Foster initially back in 1996. But what Bud also did was when the council gave the go-ahead for us to move forward with the project, we had a very short window from September 1998 to December 1998 when we committed to host the first major international tournament.
Right.
That short window, we had to completely remove and rebuild the system that the chlorine system and the chemical system and all the systems that allowed the pool to operate. We had to completely rebuild that. That was unheard of at the time within that short window.
Sure.
But Bud knew a gentleman by the name of Lee Jackson from California Commercial Pools. And because of Bud's influence and Lee's ability to bring people onto the project, we were able to move that thing forward like that and meet the goals of getting that tournament.
and allow the USA Women's Water Polo Team to start training and competing in their own home pool for their first ever Olympics in 2000. The gift of an Olympic pool that could finally start giving.
I remember that day, the team came in and the general came over. Remember, the pool looked good, but the surrounding buildings were horrible. There was probably a 40-year-old wooden fence around. There was dirt all around it. But the pride the team had that we finally were getting our own pool, it was palpable. On October 10, 1998, Aquatic Foundation Chairman Ron Bates announced to a poolside audience of supporters the USA Water Polo National Training Center Olympic Pool and its women's water polo team would host its first International Women's Holiday Cup tournament in December.
As we've mentioned, this, in addition to being a community facility, is also a U.S. training facility for the United States water polo team. And we're really happy to have them as partners. For those of you that have been around here for a while, maybe you recall maybe 5 years ago coming to this pool site, looking behind you and seeing basically, how would I call it, a filthy, muddy, cruddy, algae-covered hole with a little water in it. I mean, this thing was in terrible shape, not usable by anything, let alone the frogs and other things that were floating around. The U.S. Water Polo Organization also was looking for a training facility in this area. And through the efforts of Rich Foster, Bruce Weigo, the executive director, they were able to raise some funding to put nearly $500,000 into this pool to get it to where it is today. So really, without their help and their initial involvement and continued involvement, we wouldn't be where we are today on having this available for the military, U.S. water polo, and the community to use.
The trouble was, except for the pool itself, there wasn't much by the way of facilities to use. No bathrooms to speak of, or indoor showers, no permanent bleachers. Just tents for dressing rooms. There wasn't even a wall around the place except for an old whitewashed fence around the pool perimeter. And incredibly, even that was blown down and scattered across the grounds by a freak tornado that blew through the area just 3 days before the first women's water polo tournament was to begin on December 10th. But there was a pool, and to the USA women's water polo team who'd been wandering from pool to pool for years like self-described gypsies, it was the promised land. Temporary fencing and some rented bleachers were hurriedly put into place, and the very first International Women's Water Polo Holiday Cup was on. The very first women's Olympic water polo captain, Julie Swale, tells Ardina Deerdorf Schmidt what a home of their own felt like. After they cleared out the frogs, of course.
We found out that we were going to use the pool, and when I first saw the pool, I thought there was no way I'm going to swim in that thing. It was green, there was algae on the bottom, it looked totally disgusting. I think I'd rather go swim in the jetty water, where you know that all the runoff is coming out, than to swim in the pool here. But lo and behold, they cleaned it up, and when we came the first day for practice, it was sparkling clean, and we were so proud to have a facility to call our own. And really, at the time, it was just simply a pool. There weren't bleachers, there wasn't grass, there weren't showers, there wasn't a locker room, it was just a pool, but we are still so proud to have it. And that first year was really bumpy. We hosted our first tournament in December of 1997, and we had three other countries come for the Holiday Cup. And the day before the tournament opened, there was a tornado that came through Long Beach and Los Alamitos. And of all the times to have a tornado, Southern California doesn't have tornadoes, but it pulled out the fence, it put the fence in the pool. It was just a makeshift little wooden fence. And we showed up the next day for practice, the morning of the game. And again, there was nothing but a pool. So the little improvements that were made were then washed away. So we started again from scratch, and the following year we made little improvements. We took one of the rooms and made it into a locker room. Again, it was just lockers. There were no showers, no bathroom. We had an outhouse for a bathroom at one point.
Wow.
And we upgraded. We put AstroTurf on the floor of our locker room and felt like, you know, we were really stepping up. And that was our home. And so we just knew that if we were going to shower, we had to do it at home after practice. And, we sometimes shared. There was one bathroom. We had to share it with anyone else on the base that was needing to use the facilities. But it was nice to have a place. And we practiced 6 to 8 hours a day. And it was nice just to know that this was where we were coming for practice. We didn't have to worry about driving too far. We all lived centrally located so that we could practice and get home to rest, to come back to practice again. And so that made a huge difference in our training. And it really helped facilitate our berth to the Olympics in 2000, and also our Olympic silver medal.
I'm sure, and you were the team captain, so it was up to you, even prior to this pool, to keep this team together and move forward, and then you had the pool, and it must have been somewhat of a relief, even though it wasn't an aquatics facility at the time, it was at least a place to get together.
It was, even though it was small, we were kind of the team, like the little engine that could. You know, nobody thought that we were gonna qualify for the Olympics, and we defied the odds, and we did that. Nobody thought that we'd medal at the Olympics, and we defied the odds that did that. And we could sort of parallel ourselves with the pool here. Nobody thought this pool was going to be able to be used or inhabitable. And sure enough, through the city government and state grants, improvements were made little by little in this pool, which facilitated our training here. And so we knew going in, we were up against adversity, but we knew that we had seen miracles happen and that we could provide one of those miracles as well. And I think that the roots of this team really parallel the roots of this facility.
One of Julie Swale's original 1998 teammates, Brenda Villa, is the current captain of the USA Women's Olympic water polo team and veteran now of four Olympics. Standing alongside 19-year-old Maggie Steffens, the newbie to the team, both acknowledge the value of a home base to train and veteran teammates to train up to.
Amazing. Tell us about what it was like in the beginning for you. I understand that you guys were relatively homeless before this facility came to be your home.
You know, it's been awesome to have a place to call home. This pool here in Los Alamitos, we've had it, or I've been training here since 2000. But even then, we would run to the weight room maybe a mile down and then come back. So it was still like a work in progress, but it was nice to be able to know where all your teammates would live. We all live, 5 to 6 miles away from here, and it's always good, like, okay, this isn't another Olympic year. We're going to move down to Southern California. Our pool is in Los Alamitos. So it's good to know that you can picture that in your mind. Like, okay, 4 years from now, if I'm still going for it and I'm training for another Olympic team, I know where I'll be.
It must be phenomenal. Now you have your own weight room. So you basically can do all of your training at this facility.
Yes, we do everything here. We don't leave the pool. We train 6 hours a day. But what's really cool is we have a team room. So in the morning, we come in, we lift our weights, we get in, we swim. It's all efficient. We go home. But if we need to come in and do an extra video session with our coach about something, we have a team room where we could hang out. There's couches in there that the USOC has provided. So they really have made it very comfortable here for us.
And Maggie, you're new. What's it like to make the Olympic team for the first time?
It's very exciting. You know, I've been dreaming of being an Olympian ever since I was little. Mia Hamm was my idol, but obviously not a soccer player. So it's pretty amazing. It's unreal. And I've been looking up to a lot of these girls, too, since I was little. So it's amazing to be on their team.
Three-time Olympic women's water polo head coach Guy Baker has taken the team from amateur standing to world-class contenders. Like the pool itself, Baker says, the success of the women's team was a long shot that took a leap of faith and a couple of Hail Marys along the way.
Well, we as the public are super excited about the London Olympics. We're excited about this facility and all the things that it has led into. Can you give me a closing thought on the facility and where we are now?
Yeah, I think where the pool, like where it started, you know, it's similar. You know, it's even like where the team started. No one gave us a shot to even make the Olympic Games. No one gave us a shot once we made the Olympic Games to actually win a medal at the Olympic Games. When this pool first started, no one gave it a shot. It actually started, it had a start, restart, going, maybe funding, no funding. And it's been said it's a miracle. It's been said it was a miracle that we actually did well. During that time period, it's a miracle we actually had a pool, and I think it all ties in.
By the winter of 98, the women's team had hosted their first Holiday Cup games at the Aquatic Center in Los Alamitos. And in 99, they would steadily expand their aspirations, their victories, and their fan base. Meanwhile, the city and its recreation department were in full operational control of the pool and actively raising money for still much-needed improvements. It was clear by this time that portable toilets and temporary bleachers were just not acceptable decor for an Olympic home venue or for the expanding number of local clubs and rec swim programs clamoring for pool use as well. With a combination of county grant funds, private donations, and resourceful management. By the end of 99, with the addition of new bleachers and permanent night lights, this once abandoned pool began to look like the Olympic venue it was destined to be. One of the earliest swim clubs to come to the Aquatic Center and contribute to as well as benefit from these new upgrades was the Seal Beach Swim Club in 1999. Anxious to run their programs in a larger 50-meter Olympic pool and just as excited to be sharing the water with a soon-to-be Olympic medal water polo team. Coach Patty Haney and manager Maria Fatal operate the club to this day and remember how exciting a time it was, especially for the kids to train in the same pool as their heroes.
Patty, you're the head coach. We all know how hard it is to find home pools. I know you probably trained at various pools. What's it like to have this as a home pool for your team?
Well, when we were at McGaw, we only had six lanes, so they had to have one group go, and then the next group, and the next group. So you started at 3 o'clock, and you went till quite late. Here, we can get our entire team in the pool from 4:30 to 6:30. We've got the entire pool, all our kids swim. The kids don't have to go in different groups. They all swim at the same time, which makes it nice for parents. They don't have to have different dinners. They all are done at the same time and they go home. So it's been wonderful having the entire pool for us to train in.
And Maria, I'm sure that you're invested in many ways in this pool. One being probably things that your team has purchased to make your training better. Can you talk about that a little bit?
Right, besides lane lines and flags and blocks that we've used, we've helped purchase things like put money in to get the bleachers going. The pool's been redone a few times and it'll be done in the future again, needs to be painted every few years. We also invest in those types of things, repairing pool decks, etc.
Okay. And a lot of the different user groups, I know there are many, their hope is to bring these kids in and get them on the Olympic team, which we've seen with some of the athletes recently being in the middle of Olympic trials for a lot of sports. What can you tell us, either one of you, about some of your athletes that have gone through this journey and been successful anywhere from college scholarships to making the Olympic team?
Well, we've had, as a swimmer, Jessica Hardy swam here till she was 16 and made the Olympic trials with the club, so that was real exciting. And now watching her on the TV, the kids have all, you know, some of the kids have been on the team when she was here, and they remember her, and they're real excited to see her and cheering her on, and now that she's made the team, it's real exciting. We've also had some swimmers, back in the olden days, a lot of the kids came through swim teams before they joined water polo, and so we have Tim Hutton, and I'm trying to think who else. I mean, I've had other kids that swam with me in other clubs, Julie Swale, Robin Beauregard, they've all been on the national team, on the Olympic team, and they all started in swim programs actually that I was with at the time. But I'm trying to think, who else do we have that? And well, her daughter.
Okay, let's hear about that.
Very similar situation. She came in 99 when we first came in, and the women's team was actually US women's water polo national team was in here training. She watched them play. It was a sport that she had just started playing when she was young, 6 and 7 years old. And often they crossed in the locker room, the players and the young swimmers, and it was just exciting for her to see them. We would come in early, often right after school, and practice wouldn't start for another hour or so, so she had an opportunity to watch some of their training and see what was happening, as a number of our swimmers had the opportunity to do that. So they saw the hard work that those athletes put in. And saw the rewards also going to 2000, 2004, and 2008 and medaling all 4 years. One of her favorite athletes was Brenda Villa, and she was way shorter than Brenda at that point. Brenda's not very tall, as you know, but an incredible water polo player. And my daughter's goal was always to get taller. Am I going to be taller someday than Brenda Villa so I can play on the national team? And of course she is now, she's taller than Brenda Villa is, and she's had an opportunity now after swimming and training and playing water polo and being part of the U.S. Youth team and junior team to train actually with the senior national team and Brenda Villa.
Wow.
Seal Beach Swim Club and all the other user groups that inhabit this pool have become essential components to the financial health of pool operations. But in those early days, it would be the women's Olympic water polo team themselves, whom Supervisor Silva called simply icing on the cake, who would soon play a crucial role in closing the funding gap that would pay for many of those still desperately needed upgrades and rising operating costs, and would finally put the Los Alamitos Aquatic Center on a path to success.
Now, let me ask you something. It took about 100 years for women to get seated in water polo. What was that all about?
Well, the men's water polo is the oldest Olympic team sport. They started in 1904, and there had been attempts to get women's water polo in the Olympics dating back to the 30s, and it was never successful, and largely opposed, unfortunately, by countries that had strong men's teams, because they didn't want to have to share resources with a women's team. But there was an international effort in the 90s. I was part of that, and we lobbied across the world to get it. We lobbied with FINA, the international organization, and then I think it was around 98, they made the announcement there will be women's water polo in the Olympic Games.
I'd like to recite a quote from Rich Foster. If it hadn't been the involvement of women's water polo, there would not have been an Olympic water polo program.
Yeah.
I mean, it was that important. And of course, they go on and win a silver medal in the 2000 Olympics.
Yeah, obviously everybody's really excited about that silver medal, but before that, they weren't really considered a strong medal contender. They had to go to a qualification tournament and had to qualify for Olympics there, and they ended up surprising everybody by getting the qualification there to go to the Olympics in Sydney.
In that miraculous Olympic year of 2000, the women's water polo team unexpectedly defeated the strongly favored Hungarians in Italy to earn a last seat at the Sydney Olympics, then go on to battle their way to silver medal, losing only to the mighty Australians in the last minutes of the Olympic match.
Medal, and it is all Australia, 10-8, congratulations.
And so here we had a team that trained in Los Alamitos, goes to Sydney, brings back silver medals, and if you asked the common phrase back then is from the team is we did it the Los Al way. But that energy and excitement from the women's Olympic water polo team generated enthusiasm at the state and local level to increase funding.
In the midst of this magical year, a funny thing happened on the way to the Olympics. The women's water polo team, all 13 of them, paid a visit to Gray Davis himself at the Democratic National Convention in Los Angeles and made a direct appeal to the governor on behalf of their new Olympic home. A plea for state grant support from others so far had fallen on deaf political ears at a very contentious time in state politics. Still, they took a shot.
You know, in July of 2000, now you had the first group of women representing the United States of America. Well, they were on demand, even though they hadn't played in the Olympics yet. We had the Democratic Presidential National Convention was being hosted in Los Angeles, and the women and their coach, Guy Baker, were invited to that national convention. And they had the opportunity to not only meet, but have pictures taken with Governor Gray Davis and his wife. And that set the seed for what happened with the funding the following year.
Yes, you got the funding.
Yeah, it was interesting.
That's why we call this the 50-meter miracle.
50-meter miracle. Because typically when a member's request of funding is not fulfilled, it doesn't come back in. It's almost unheard of to bring it back in. But we decided we would bring it back forward to the House and to the Senate. And again, it went through the same process. The women now were on their way to Sydney, Australia in September. The budget was being developed by the governor and his staff. And the women went to Australia, played against Australia, and ended up with the silver medal. And again, the funding for this project, $300,000 plus now, was put into the budget for this fiscal year. And in May of 2001, similar kind of scenario from the year before, the governor came to the Republicans here in Orange County and said, you need to support my budget, otherwise any requests for projects in your community isn't going to be fulfilled. And the governors, the Republicans wouldn't support the budget. So every member's request that had Republican marked was pulled out of the budget, except
the pool.
For the pool.
Wow.
That $355,000 state grant to the city of Los Alamitos provided timely and much needed capital to purchase pool apparatus, install badly needed bathroom and shower facilities, and support maintenance and periodic upgrades to the pool's infrastructure for years to come. Soon after,
ladies and gentlemen, Governor Gray Davis.
Governor Davis visited the Joint Forces Training Base to give a 4th of July address before the annual fireworks show. Taking the time to visit the nearby Olympic pool he had just appropriated state funds to, he must have liked what he saw as he jumped on a bicycle for a once around the pool he helped to save. In November of 2000, the city of Los Alamitos welcomed home its women's Olympic silver medal winners with a reception and an outpouring of gratitude for the role they played in bringing recognition to the aquatic pool and the city. A gratitude Rich Foster tells a Los Al audience that goes both ways.
Let me tell you, this city council is behind this team. I haven't seen in my 20, 25 years in sports a city council and a team that have clicked together like this. And Mayor Pro Tem, we really appreciate the city's involvement. And we hope that we can do our part to get the city of Los Alamitos on national TV once in a while and to make it the home of U.S. water polo.
We feel that our residents have really taken to this idea of having a pool here, and they feel tremendously proud that it has helped to accomplish such wonderful things. I really feel that a very, very nice partnership has been developed between the U.S. Water Polo Team and our city, and that that we can provide something that can help these people be the very best in the world. And what I'd really like to emphasize is that you have no idea the sense of pride that was all over in this city when we read in the newspapers that you wanted to go out and play the Los Al way. Wow.
That women's team, I had a chance to interact with them on a number of occasions, you know, receptions, dinners that were being hosted in their honor. And it was a great, great group of women. Julie Swale was their captain, and just a really nice person. Later, I might add, an Olympian in the triathlon for the United States. So just a great, great team overall. And certainly throughout this process, their inspiration and working, I might say, with some of the elected officials, with the governor on an occasion when we were trying to persuade him that this was the right allocation of $355,000, they were helpful, as were all the elected officials who were putting pressure on the governor to make this contribution. And I think just the general public and the business community who was helping contribute to a lot of the improvements there. And I might add the military, who improved their whole facility there to go along with the improvement in the pool. So again, as I mentioned, really a joint effort, a lot of people on the same page at the right time.
The Los Alamitos City Council has presided over the progress of the Aquatic Center since 1998. And no council member has been more supportive of the pool than Marilyn Poe, who has attended almost every milestone the pool has seen, including the planting of this small sapling outside the pool's gates in the year 2000 to honor the USA Women's Water Polo Team, our home team.
I remember so well when the entire council came out to this site and we planted a sapling tree right here, along with this plaque on this stone. It's called the Olympic Tree, dedicated to the first United States women's Olympic water polo team. And it was in preparation for them to go to Sydney, Australia for the 2000 Olympics. We were able to do this with the support of the entire city council. There was a vision that this was a real asset for this community. The pool, we were so proud of the fact that the women's Olympic team trained here. They really put our city on the map. The little city that could and did. We had a lot of vision at that time. We were a little scared, a little skeptical that we were going to be able to pull it off. But with the help of all of the businesses in the community, the contractors that stepped up to the plate, so many people that have already been mentioned and will be mentioned in this documentary, we have been able to create a wonderful asset for this community so that we can teach children how to swim. Being water safe, learning how to swim was so important to all of us. And of course, we can't forget the individuals, hundreds of individuals, who supported with a giving spirit by donating $25, $50, $75 into the bricks that you see here. That same type of spirit that moved the city council back in the 90s to give their support for this program. And we'll continue to give the support for this wonderful pool into the future.
There is no better example of many people on the same page than the largely public effort to build a USA Women's weight room just off the pool deck. Endurance is a crucial component of success, especially for water polo athletes. Such a facility was badly needed for the team to be truly competitive on a world-class level. But constructing a wing under the existing building would cost upwards of $50,000. So the city council set up a commemorative brick program and then appealed to the community for donations. It took a year to raise the capital, coming primarily out of lots of little pockets over a long period of time. But they got there, literally, brick by brick. Where there was a need, they found a way, even if sometimes it was the hard way, the LaSalle way. From its inauspicious beginnings in the mid-90s as a half-drained frog pond, this 50-meter pool has struggled, stumbled, and at times against all odds, like the women's water polo team it hosts, blossomed into an oasis for water sports, and it has now added the honor of hosting an Olympic gold medal home team that has brought international acclaim to this 50-meter marathon. But the greatest pride that accompanies this pool and its Cinderella story resides in its support of the numerous swim clubs, recreation and safety programs, and the public in general who benefit on a daily basis. Over 200,000 kids and adults a year will pass through these gates to take part in programs as diverse as junior lifeguards,
the heart is a blue.
A disabled veterans underwater scuba program. And of course, water polo at all levels of training and competition. These days, pool operations at the Aquatic Center often run into the night with popular competitive swim clubs like the International Water Polo Club of Los Alamitos. Head coach and director Brahm Hodre's program puts hundreds of kids, teens, and young adults into the pool several days and nights a week for intense water polo training and opportunities for advancement.
Tell me why an organization like this is important. I guess they call them feeder organizations for the national teams and even the Olympic team, which practices here too.
We definitely, I mean, we're very fortunate, first of all, that it's the National Training Center where all the Olympians come in and go at this pool site through various times of the day and the year. But in a club setting like ours, we feed into the local high schools. We feed into the major colleges. And ultimately, we get a lot of national team players from our club. And if we get really fortunate, a few of them might actually make the Olympics and might come back with a gold medal around their neck. So we're really lucky. But we also bring back players. You know, once their competitive playing careers are done, they still want to play recreation style and in an adult league fashion. We offer that too.
You've seen a lot of changes then here at the pool.
Yes.
Because I know things were not quite as set up back then as they are now.
Yeah.
Tell me a little bit about some of the changes and some of the developments here at the pool that enhanced your club.
In the early years, it was just water. We didn't have lights, we didn't have bleachers, we didn't have these walls and fences. It was just water, and as the years went on, we you know, there's a lot of funding and a lot of grant money and sponsors that came in and helped with the buildings, the weight rooms. The USOC helped spend money to build a really nice Olympic weight room for the Olympians. The lights, a couple $100,000, they came in about 2000, 2001. The bleachers came in about 2001. You know, so a lot of improvements, and it just brings a lot of excitement to the community and the pool. And we're just trying to be known as a water polo city, a water polo powerhouse. Los Alamitos has traditionally been, you know, football, baseball, basketball, you know, the traditional sports. And we want to be also known as a water polo powerhouse. We've hosted a lot of international tournaments over the years. And college NC2A championships have also been hosted here, and a lot of high school championships have been hosted here. So it just brings more excitement in, not just on the physical structure, but just kind of the feeling that when you come to Los Alamitos at the Joint Forces Training Base, it's a home for water polo.
Brahm Hodre's comments support what Guy Baker and the women's water polo team call the Los Al way. Against all odds, to overcome and achieve. Like the women of water polo who overcame in 2000 with a long shot silver medal. And overcame again in 2008 with another silver. And again in 2012, defeating their arch rival Australia in overtime.
The United States goes to the gold medal game with an overtime win over Australia, 11-9.
And finally, going on to topple top-rated Spain for the crowning achievement of Olympic gold.
For the first time, one love, one team, no losses, gold medals.
This 50-meter pool that sat abandoned in 1995 owes its resurrection in part to these young athletes who defied the odds, took their long shot, and turned it into gold. And to the bold thinkers, planners, and builders who also defied the odds, worked past the adversities, and built a coalition of doers who believed in themselves, their athletes, their kids. The pool itself and ultimately in the belief that miracles just don't happen. They are fought for, and they are earned.
We like to think of this as our pool. There's just no other pool like it.
And thanks to all these miracle workers, we here in Los Alamitos have an Olympic pool with an inspiring history and our very own backyard here today and for the children tomorrow. We did that, all of us together. And that is a miracle, a 50-meter miracle, to be exact. Now, if you'll excuse me, I'm going to take a dip in my Olympic pool.
See you on the road, and when the-